to present Mr. Gordon Chang.
Thank you, Catherine. Thank you to the club. But most of all, thank you to all of you for your unwavering defense of our way of life, our society, and our republic. Thank you. What does China really want? You've heard the mainstream media talk about this. You've heard Biden call Chinese communist rulers, quote, not bad folks. Here are the facts. The People's Republic of China wants to take away your sovereignty and to rule the world, and it also wants to rule the near parts of the solar system. Yes, that sounds ludicrous, but no, I'm not exaggerating. With regard to planet, Xi Jinping, Chinese ruler wants to take down the existing Westphalian international order, and in its place, he would like to impose China's imperial era system, in which Chinese emperors not only believed that they had the mandate of heaven to rule Tianxia, all under heaven, they believed that heaven compelled them to do so. Now, Xi Jinping has employed Tianxia language for more than a decade. But recently, his references have become unmistakable. So for instance, in his 2017 New Year's message, he said, quote, the Chinese have always held that the world is united and all under heaven, there's that phrase, all under heaven are one family. And if that weren't bad enough, Wang Yi, his foreign minister, wrote in Study Times, which is the authoritative newspaper of China's Central Party School. He wrote this in September 2017, that Xi Jinping thought that a Communist Party lingo of thought is an important ideological body of work. Wang Yi wrote that Xi Jinping thought made innovations on and transcended the traditional Western international relations thinking of the past 300 years. So you take 2017, you subtract 300, and you almost get to 1648. And Wang Yi, with his time reference, was pointing to the Treaty of Westphalia of 1648, which established today's current international system of sovereign states, which compete and cooperate as they see fit. So when Wang Yi says that Xi Jinping wants to transcend this system, what he's really saying is that China's ruler believes that there are no sovereign states, or at least there's no more of them than China. So you've heard a lot of people on TV and elsewhere say, oh, you know, China just wants to compete with us, they want to be world number one. And yeah, that is acceptable in our current international system, but that's not right. Because Xi Jinping does not want to compete with the United States or any other country in the existing international system. He doesn't even want to adjust that system. He wants to overthrow it altogether, which means that China, once again, is ruled by a revolutionary. With regard to the solar system, beginning in 2018, Chinese officials have talked about how the moon and Mars should be part of the People's Republic of China. In other words, sovereign Chinese territory. They view those heavenly bodies as like the South China Sea. Theirs and theirs alone. And they've been talking about excluding other nations from going there if the Chinese can get there first and establish permanent operations. Just a few hours ago, China landed its rover on Mars, called Zhurong. About 2 weeks ago, Beijing announced the name and said Zhurong is a mythical Chinese god of fire. And with regard to Mars, that makes sense. What Beijing didn't tell you is that Zhurong is also a Chinese god of war, and he's the god of the South China Sea. Now that we know what China wants, how are they going to get it? Today we'll quickly talk about three things: disease, subversion, and fentanyl. First, disease. Where did COVID-19 start? Well, the Daily Mail reported that in December of last year, then National Security, Deputy National Security Advisor Matt Pottinger told British parliamentarians in a Zoom call that the United States felt that the most credible source of COVID-19 was the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And by the way, it's very dangerous for me to talk about these subjects with our guests here who are noted virologists. Also, Pottinger said he believed that Chinese officials themselves discounted and did not believe their own pronouncements about the wet market theory and zoonotic transfers. A couple of weeks ago, Richard Dearlove, who was the head of MI6 at the turn of the century, said that it was more probable than not that SARS-CoV-2, the pathogen that causes COVID-19, came from the Wuhan lab. And then he said it looked, quote unquote, somewhat tailored. More important, right at this moment, we don't know exactly where SARS-CoV-2 came from, but we do know one thing. We know that China's rulers have done their best to prevent the international community from investigating the sources of this disease. So, for instance, Beijing did its best to hinder the World Health Organization's most recent mission to Wuhan in January and February. Specifically, what they did was they prevented the mission members from studying raw patient data, especially the raw patient data of 174 Chinese COVID patients, because the Wuhan mission felt that they could tell us where the disease came from. And it's no wonder that China is trying to hide this. We know that the Wuhan Institute of Virology was storing more than 1,500 strains of coronavirus. It was engaged in dangerous gain-of-function research. Thank you, Dr. Fauci. We know, for instance, also that this had military members working there. The Wuhan Institute failed to adhere to safety protocols. And interestingly, it is located just miles from the first identified COVID-19 patient in the part of China that never generates disease. Moreover, it's highly suspicious that in late January of last year, China sent the person who is often described in the press as China's top biological weapons expert, that's Major General Chen Wei, they sent her to head the P4 biosafety unit at the Wuhan Institute, and I think that she was sent there for two reasons. First of all, to clean up evidence of a leak from the lab, but also, and maybe this is even more important, to clean up evidence of a biological weapons program. Now, even if SARS-CoV-2 didn't start out in life as a biological weapon, we know that Chinese leaders turned it into one. So for instance, for at least 5 years, and probably 5 months, if you look at a Harvard Medical School study, the Chinese leaders knew this disease was highly contagious. But during those 5 weeks, starting in the second week of December, they tried to tell the world it was not transmissible from one person to the next. They lied about this. Also, during this period, Xi Jinping, he tried to pressure countries not to impose travel restrictions and quarantines on arrivals from China while he was locking down Wuhan and surrounding cities. Now, forget the moment the controversy about lockdowns, but Xi Jinping obviously thought in his own mind that lockdowns were effective because he was shutting down his own country, which means that he must have thought that by forcing other countries to accept arrivals from China, that he was spreading this disease. There's only one explanation that fits the facts, that the spread of COVID-19 beyond China's borders was malicious. This is the first time in history that one nation has attacked all others, and we now have 3.2 million deaths around the world, and that is mass murder. We don't know what Xi Jinping was thinking, but but if after having seen COVID-19 cripple his own country, if he wanted to level the playing field by spreading the disease elsewhere, he would have done exactly what he did. Is Chinese communism this malicious?
Yep.
Well, Chinese communists, they believe in what's known as comprehensive national power. It's an empirical framework that they borrowed from the Soviets, and it's used to rank countries according to different metrics. Now, China, of course, wants to be number one. And there's two ways to get to be number one. You either strengthen your own country, which is fair game, or you weaken other countries. And what Xi Jinping did was he was weakening other countries. Second subject is subversion. China is trying to subvert us, and it's doing so in a number of different ways. One of them is, since about the second week of February of last year, China has been engaged in malicious disinformation campaigns. So for instance, on March 12th, the Foreign Ministry, along with the Global Times, talked about how COVID-19 started in the United States. They said, this is from an official Twitter account, that patient zero was in the U.S. And then they suggested that it was the U.S. Army that brought the disease to Wuhan. Obviously absurd, but they've continued this theme. And just about 3-4 weeks ago, they then picked this up, and now they're saying that COVID-19 started a few miles from here, in Frederick, Maryland, which is the site of the U.S. Army's fourth teacher. Well, why is this important? Because China is thinking that we spread the disease. But we know what the Chinese are doing. And the reason why this is so important for us is that we have to establish deterrence. This is not the last pathogen that has come from China's soil. And we've got to prevent Xi Jinping from spreading the next disease again. And we can see that they intend to do this with their propaganda. And let's be clear. The Chinese are working on new sorts of pathogens. In 2017, the Authoritative Science of Military Strategy, which is a publication of China's National Defense University, actually talked about a new type of biological warfare, quote, specific ethnic genetic attacks. That means a pathogen from China, which could be the next one, could leave the Chinese immune and sicken everybody else, which would mean that China might be the world's only viable society. So that's what we have got at stake here. We know that China is trying to subvert our political system, trying to change outcomes. We do this with their troll and their other operations, which from all indications were Russia's. So now it's time to talk about TikTok, that wildly popular mobile video sharing app, which as of the beginning of this month, had a CEO who was closely connected to the Chinese Communist Party. Now, engineers for Douyin, which is TikTok's sister site, are the ones responsible for managing TikTok's algorithms, including the algorithm that curates videos. In other words, it's the algorithm that determines which videos your kids see and which videos they do not. And this is what makes TikTok so popular, because it sends the stuff that you want to see, and it doesn't send the stuff that you won't be interested in. But this gives Beijing not only the ability to distribute cat videos, it also allows them to try to change political opinion in the United States. We call that boosting the signal. And there are a number of indications that Beijing did that in last year to try to change the outcome of our presidential election. And now we're at the subject of, why did the State Department in July of last year close the Houston consulate of China? Well, China had four other consulates. And the state said, well, the Houston consulate was involved in espionage. Well, if that's the reason, we know that the other four consulates were also involved in spying, as well as the embassy staff in Washington. So why Houston? I think the real explanation is because China was using Houston to provide logistical and financial support to violent protesters in the United States. A report from Radio Free Asia last year says that an intelligence unit of the People's Liberation Army actually based themselves in the Houston consulate, and from there they were using big data and artificial intelligence to identify Americans likely to participate in Black Lives Matter and Antifa protests. And then the Chinese military sent them videos via TikTok on how to lie. Trying to incite violence on American streets is more than just subversion. It is an act of war. And there are also indications that China's gone beyond mere incitement and has actually been organizing protesters. We saw this perhaps on the night of May 31st of last year, one block north of the White House. That's the night that St. John's Church was burned. There are multiple reports, unconfirmed, but multiple reports, that many protesters were speaking Mandarin. They were obviously acting in coordination with each other, and a couple of them were overheard saying things that suggested that the Chinese government was the one putting them on the streets to riot when locked up in the White House. Now, these reports mirror the indications of Chinese protesters in Southern California locations, including Los Angeles. There are other suspicious reports. So, for instance, in late January of last year, U.S. Customs and Border Protection at the International Falls Port of Entry in Minnesota intercepted 900,000 counterfeit $1 bills. Why? Nobody counterfeits $1 bills for profit, and nobody in China's near total surveillance state could make our money without Beijing knowing about it. So this operation had Beijing's blessing. So what's going on now? I only have a guess that what China was trying to do was to try to provide financial support to protesters in a way that wouldn't be caught by authorities. I don't know. But I do know that counterfeiting another country's currency is an act of war. May of last year, Customs and Border Protection agents seized automatic weapons parts coming from China. I don't know what's going on here, but there are no good explanations. This brings us to our last topic, which is fentanyl. Fentanyl is the synthetic compound, highly addictive. Chinese technicians actually manipulate the compounds to make it more addictive. And indeed, they do this so that they get to avoid protection as it comes into the U.S. It comes into the U.S. directly, sometimes through the U.S. mail. Now it's coming through more and more through Mexico because we have an open border, and Chinese gangs are flooding into Vancouver to set up operations there. Now we know that this fentanyl is highly addictive and it's killed Americans in great numbers. We don't have the death toll from fentanyl for last year, but it's probably about 45,000 when you count not only fentanyl deaths, but also the increasing number of deaths from cocaine and methamphetamines because those substances are mixed with fentanyl. Like the counterfeit currency from China, nobody can operate a large-scale fentanyl gang in China without the authorities knowing about it. So the authorities there obviously know about it, they probably approve of it, and in many cases there are indications that they're profiting. So what do we do about this? I put together a checklist of action items, and I'm going to present it to you because no disrespect to the men in the room, I do know that women get things done. That's one of the lessons I've learned from 27 years of marriage. My wife just said it's an important lesson. Yes, it is, and it was learned the hard way. In general, and this cuts across all the recommendations that you will hear, in general, we need to cut our ties with China. China uses every point of contact with the United States to undermine our society, to subvert us. And so they're overwhelming the United States at the moment. At the moment, they're overwhelming the FBI, they're overwhelming local law enforcement, they're overwhelming local governments and private institutions. So the only way that we can deal with this is to cut those links quickly until we can figure out whether we can manage this. Patients for humans are reformable. That means that our contact with it will always be dangerous. So we need to reduce that contact. An American president has the power to do this. An American president can invoke his powers under the International Emergency Economic Powers Act of 1977, or if he really gets serious, which he should, he can invoke the Trading with the Enemy Act of 1917. These are things that we have got to do. I've got 7 action items, plus I've got a 7th for you. First thing, we need to cut our trade links with China. We should not be enriching a hostile regime that intends to destroy our society. How do we know that? May 2019, People's Daily, the most authoritative publication in China, carried a piece that declared, quote unquote, people's war on us. They're an enemy, because they've told us we are the enemy. Therefore, we shouldn't be helping them. We should not be supporting their military. One of the things we need to do is get our companies off of Chinese soil, especially our pharmaceutical companies. And we need to start making our own personal protective equipment, because China has threatened, and they've done this from an official Xinhua news agency, they did this last year, they threatened to throw the United States into a, quote, mighty sea of coronavirus. And these monsters are not kidding, because they, as Maria Bartiromo mentioned on air, they turned around a couple of ships carrying personal protective equipment to New York hospitals. They did this mid-ocean. As Peter Navarro, who worked for President Trump, said, China actually nationalized an American factory making N95 masks. China's leadership always says how decoupling isn't possible. Well, it is possible. It is happening. It's happening for a number of reasons. Part of it because President Trump started encouraging it. Part of it because business was doing this on its own. But we Americans must make this inevitable. Second thing, the Trump administration towards the end was making headway in terms of preventing federal pension money being invested in China's market. In other words, fueling China's bonds. President Biden, one of the first things he did is indicated he's got a backslide on that. So we've got to prevent this backsliding, and we've got to go even further, which is to prevent state pension money and private portfolio investors going into China's market. We should not be enriching a hostile Chinese regime with our investment dollars. Third, we should expel Chinese agents from our country. And to do this, I believe that we need to close the other 4 Chinese consulates, and we need to cut the embassy staff in Washington down from thousands just to the ambassador and perhaps his family. We need to turf out Chinese businesses, especially state banks. Fourth thing, we must demand reciprocity. If China doesn't allow our apps in China, we shouldn't allow Chinese apps in ours. Second thing, if China doesn't allow our media into China, why should we allow China's media into ours? And also, if we can't have a Reagan Institute in China, why would we allow Confucius Institutes on our colleges and university campuses? And even more important, we need to turf out the 500 Confucius classrooms in our secondary schools. Fifth thing, this seems common sense, but somehow it's eluded a number of American presidents. We need to prevent China from systematically using its nationals for gathering intelligence in our country. We need to stop Chinese diplomats and administrative state security agents. We need to continue the process started by Mike Pompeo, Secretary of State, of eliminating their journalists from our soil. It's not only a question of reciprocity, it's also a question of intelligence gathering. We have to remember, and this is difficult for us, we have to remember that China's 2017 National Intelligence securities law requires every Chinese national and every Chinese company to spy for Beijing if demanded. We've had a series of American presidents who've known this and haven't done anything about it. That stops now. Seventh thing, we should not allow China to buy our tech companies. I mean, we incredibly have allowed China to do this, including a American company that had a large profile of DNA information about Americans. If you want to find the world's largest source, the world's largest collection of DNA profiles of Americans, you do not look in America. You look in China. And part of that is because they were allowed in 2013 to buy the company Complete Genomics. One other thing, we should end all technical cooperation agreements between American entities and China. We're just giving away a lot of technology. And that we should not be doing. Now, all of these seven steps will take political will, they'll require education, they'll require grassroots organizing, they'll require that we elect candidates who will not support Chinese communist positions. This won't be easy. But there are certain things that we ourselves can do on our own. And those are the additional three steps I talked about. First thing, we can tell our brokers to sell Chinese equities. Second thing, when possible, let's not buy Chinese products. And third thing, let's pressure websites to be COOL, COOL, country of origin labeling. Because at least if we do that, we will be able to make informed choices of whose products we want to buy. And I can tell you there's one large Asian totalitarian state, we do not want to buy their products. This, as I said, is not going to be easy. But let's think about this for a moment. What are our children and our grandchildren going to think if they realize we had the means to protect them and we decided not to do so? Ladies and gentlemen, this is our Lexington and Concord moment. America is worth fighting for, and the defense of our nation starts now. Thank you.